Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and by other public television stations, and by the following.
Publication of his new book, Wealth and Poverty, George Gilder emerges as arguably the leading social theorist of capitalism writing today. His book is extraordinary on a number of counts, not least of them that he challenges even the axiomatic assumption that capitalism is primarily animated by the desire for self-service. Even Adam Smith fares ill at the hands of George Gilder, whose book is hailed by Professor Nathan Glazer of Harvard as demolishing, quote, a host of pieties as to the causes of poverty and the conditions that overcome it. Congressman David Stockman, named by Governor Reagan as head of the Bureau of Budget Management, says of it that it, quote, shatters once and for all the Keynesian and welfare state illusions that burden the failed conventional wisdom of our era. It recovers, says Stockman, the classic truths about the sources of prosperity and growth just in time. George Gilder, a graduate of Harvard and a former fellow at the Kennedy Institute of Politics at Harvard, is currently the program director of the International Center for Economic Policy Studies and chairman of the Economic Roundtable at the Lehman Institute. He is the author of Sexual Suicide, Visible Man, and a frequent contributor to a number of journals. Here to take issue with Mr. Gilder is Professor Robert Lekachman, a prominent socialist, a distinguished professor of economics at Lehman College at the City University of New York, author of several books, including The Age of Keynes and Economists at Bay. Our examiner will be Mrs. Harriet Pilpel, about whom more in due course. I should like to begin by asking Mr. Gilder to expand on his notion that capitalism has for two centuries been misunderstood as springing from human avarice.
Well, my central question was how people get rich. It seemed to me to explain poverty, you first had to understand wealth. And as I was interviewing poor people, I repeatedly came upon the notion that wealth came from taking, that's the source of wealth is really taking. And therefore, the way to overcome poverty is to give it back, to take it back and redistribute it. And when I began to examine just how wealth is created, it seemed to me that it arose not from taking, but giving. People get rich by giving rather than by taking. And this seemed to me to be a very important perception because the reason for the crisis in capitalism today, it seems to me, is not its practical achievements, but rather the perceptions of its moral character. I mean, I think it's more important that the Pope is a socialist than the Taiwanese and Japanese are capitalists, perhaps. It's, the fact that capitalism has such difficulty in defending itself as in accord fully with the Judeo-Christian values that underlie the good society. And the more I examined capitalism in anthropological terms or even in contemporary manifestations, the more it became clear to me that capitalists give, that is to say, that they make investments without a predetermined return. And a gift is not something given necessarily without any return. Even in the Bible, you give and
cast bread upon the waters, yeah, in the expectation they'll be returned.
That's right. And there will be some return. And what differentiates a gift from investment under socialism, for example, is that it lacks a predetermined return. And capitalists are people who are continually giving their wealth to others in the expectation of a possible return in the future, but which is not predetermined. And impulsive giving seems to me to be fundamental to the entire system.
Well, before I invite Professor Lekachman to comment on that, may I ask you how you reconcile the use of that terminology, which is certainly idiosyncratic, with the notion that the dynamism of exchange presupposes that the partners to the act both think they are coming off better than they went in. So that if I sell you this pen for a dollar, it's because I want a dollar more than I want this pen, and you want the dollar less than you want this pen. And now, this is not a gift, is it?
It's not a gift, but your investment in the enterprise that created that pen was a gift, in as much as you were not assured at the time you built that factory that anyone would in fact want to purchase such a pen. The success of that factory depended on your imaginative understanding of the needs of others. Needs or desires of others, which means an altruistic disposition, an extroverted giving sensibility rather than sensibility chiefly focused on your own needs or your own ambitions.
What if I make leather for the SM set? Am I still being altruistic?
No, because I think that capitalism and the Judeo-Christian tradition are one integral unit. They aren't separate, any sort of enterprise that subverts the sources of giving in society will ultimately defeat capitalism, and that's one of the real problems. Is a widespread belief that we should regulate economic activity ever more intensively, while it's somehow regarded offensive to attempt to regulate moral activity or even crime in many instances. And this is, as Irving Kristol put it, much better than that. But the point is that acts that are predatory in that sense ultimately destroy the system, and it cannot survive without its religious and moral foundations. And so those acts are inconsistent with the system, and the legal structure of any capitalist system should prohibit them as much as it can.
Would you like to engage in some counter-revolutionary activity, Professor Lekachman?
I'd like to start by saying that my friend George Gilder has written an extremely eloquent and, of course, almost entirely mistaken book. As far as capitalism is concerned, there's always been a strong argument for capitalism, but not a very strong ethical argument. Alfred Marshall, I think, put it as well as any pro-capitalist economist did when he said that if we're sensible, we appeal to people's strongest, not their highest motives. By the strongest motive, he meant avarice. And I think, in fact, this has been the dynamic of capitalism. If it's produced goods that people wanted, it's been, so to speak, agnostic in its feelings about their effect. Strong distilled waters, narcotics, actively harmful pornography, whatever. As long as these find markets, there will be capitalists who will be busily engaged in producing the artifacts which sell. I think, George, that you're after something when you try to find a moral basis for capitalism, because it's true, as many people have pointed out, that in its usual crass aspects, capitalism can be defended only as delivering the goods, the very material goods.
It's value-free.
value-free. Yeah. The material goods is estimated by my colleagues in the Department of Commerce when they do the national income accounts, which I agree with you, incidentally, are a wretched set of estimates of anything of importance. Nevertheless, these are the measures that are used. And by these particular criteria, capitalism succeeds when the gross national product per capita increases, falters when the gross national product slows down, is under severe indictment when, as recently, by conventional measures, it actually declines. That's my hope as a socialist, as a matter of fact. That the defense of capitalism is essentially material, and that defense is weakening as the material performance of capitalism itself diminishes.
Mr. Gilder has lots of explanations as to why the gross national product is overburdened. It's not by capitalist licentiousness, but for other reasons. But before we get to that, which is really an empirical question,
I think one of the
I wish you would reply to the other point. As you see fit. What do you want to say?
Well, I think one of the reasons is licentiousness. I think pornography subverts the family, which is the source of capitalist initiative and growth, a crucial source of capitalist development. So that I think that licentiousness of this sort is one reason for
demoralization.
Demoralization. And self-interest.
But demoralization is surely most directly affected by the overhead of enterprise, isn't it? Taxes.
Yeah, taxes are a crucial deterrent to growth and initiative. But
we'll get back. Mr. Kashmir said something quite interesting there, that he was surprised that anybody challenges the notion that the dynamic of capitalism isn't exactly what Alfred Marshall, Keynes' tutor, said it was, namely an appeal to the strongest rather than to the best instincts in man. Now, is avarice the strongest instinct in man? Do you postulate this?
No.
I didn't think you would. Now, it certainly is strongest at the level at which biologically the human organism needs to protect itself, right? If you need to eat, that will be your dominant motive,
right, yeah,
in any particular situation. It's only after you've taken care of those primary necessities that you can go on to indulge other instincts. Am I correct?
Yeah, yes, that's right.
Well, now, how do you counter, then, Mr. Lekachman's argument that the strongest passion of man namely avarice, is the engine of capitalism?
Well, avarice is ubiquitous. Capitalism occurs in some places, and avarice does not suffice to stimulate capitalism. And that's one of the great failures of the conventional theory of capitalism. Avarice and self-interest don't lead to a steadily expanding capitalist system fueled by the imaginative creativity of entrepreneurs responding to the needs of others. Avarice leads to a search for safety and security and comfort and ultimately to an ever-expanding welfare state. And that's our problem today, is that avarice does prevail to an excessive degree and thus leads to a steadily expanding welfare state rather than a creative growth.
George, if I may interpolate on that, it seemed to me reading your book, some of what you say in the book contradicts what you've just said, because if in fact avarice isn't as important as I allege, then why should you be so dreadfully concerned about the impact of the tax system on entrepreneurial activity? As I read salient portions of your book, it sounded to me very conventional, a very conventional argument that high taxes were discouraging entrepreneurial activity and that various people who otherwise might engage in productive risk-taking are now deeply depressed by the exactions of the Internal Revenue Service.
Because when they need a steadily expanding flow of profits in order to expand their businesses and thus respond more fully and creatively to the needs of others in the society. So they, in other words, if they have to consult with some bureaucrat every time they expand their company in order to get a special grant, then their creative and altruistic impulse is stifled. That's how the system works. Entrepreneurs get increasing power to respond to the needs of others as they succeed in doing so. And because they need to understand the needs of others in order to succeed, the capitalist exchange results in steadily widening circles of human sympathy and trust. And that's the way the system works and grows. If these values are subverted, then or stifled by taxation or some other method, then the system collapses, and avarice alone won't rescue it.
Well, you know, if you are right, something which I guard myself against believing, if you're right in your theme, it's difficult for me to believe that all the regulatory agencies, EPA, the Occupational Safety and Health Administration, the whole gaggle of agencies about which you're unhappy, that this set of agencies would have got the public support that they did. Don't forget, they were for the most part enacted during the Nixon period, not during the preceding or following Democratic administrations. The public support for these agencies extended far beyond miscellaneous elitist in the Sierra Club and the Friends of the Earth and so on. It extended to a great many ordinary people, a great many ordinary people who were concerned about safety in factories and the quality of the air they were breathing and the water that they were drinking. And it was this particular impulse which produced the political support which led Congress to enact a series of statutes.
But it was an undifferentiated impulse. If you had asked the same people who said, yes, by all means, let's have clean air rather than dirty air, by the way, it's going to cost you $2,500 more per automobile, they would have said, I'll take the air the way it was. Now, I don't like dirty air. I don't think I have to say that more than once, do I? But it seems to me that Mr. Gilder makes his point very well, that the notion that we can police a plebiscite out of the droppings of these various pollsters is one of the principal superstitions of our time.
That's not quite my point, though. Whether or not the regulators...
You're talking about public support. I said I thought it was indiscriminate support.
Well, but it arose from something which bears upon the major theme in George's book, which is the altruism which he imputes, by and large, to entrepreneurs. I question an altruism which produces environmental impacts and impacts upon worker health and safety, which produces even, let's, for the sake of argument, say an undifferentiated regulatory impulse. That's a separate argument.
Well, it's an argument that's difficult to halt, isn't it? Because you can say in that case anybody engaged in automobile manufacturing is engaged in something that's antisocial, since we lose every year more people to car accidental deaths than we did during the whole of the Vietnam War. It's difficult to draw the line there, isn't it?
No,
a categorical opponent of government regulation under all circumstances. I just think you have to be very careful with it.
In the interest of sweetness of light, I'm not a categorical proponent of government regulation. But the point that animates me here is, you see, the deficiencies in the practical expression of the altruism which you impute to entrepreneurs, which in a very conservative society, it was conservative before Mr. Reagan was elected in November, a very conservative society nevertheless gives rise to this regulatory impulse. It seems to me that the predisposition of most Americans is to believe that businessmen, on the whole, are good things and do them good. This is a society, after all, with no socialist party to speak of, with very conservative trade unions, who moreover enroll a diminishing percentage of the labor force. And here, nevertheless, is a society which, as you very eloquently say, has given rise either, by my lights, to a rather weak and inadequate set of regulatory agencies, or by your standards, an oppressive muddling, interfering set of bureaucrats,
dumb,
but which in either manifestation has somehow produced a very considerable regulatory activity. It seems to me at the least.
But it can be.
That doesn't conflict with anything in particular, I say.
In the first place, it can be idiopathic. Who is here to say exactly what was intended when these people enacted this particular. You people are always saying, my God, Congress intended to regulate the broadcasting business, and they ended up creating a servant of it, so that what evolves from a piece of legislation is not often related to the motivations that led to its being promulgated. But one of you ought to answer this question, because I think the audience is confused. I certainly am. If I determine to build a cheaper mousetrap in order to get your patronage, and I am motivated to line my pocket, but in the course of creating a cheaper mousetrap, I make it possible for you to purchase one, I have committed an objectively altruistic act for selfish motives. Now, do you assume that there's an incompatibility between those two concepts?
I don't, but I am focusing on the essence of capitalism. What is it that makes it succeed? What is it that makes it so extraordinary in creating wealth? I'm saying wealth is ubiquitous. These acts of creativity are rare, relatively rare, and it's the acts of creativity that have to be explained, and you have to explain their essence rather. And all human motives are mixed in various ways. All human beings sin. They're avaricious. They're evil in various ways. The question is, what is it about the capitalist system that makes it so miraculous in the creation of wealth? I don't think it's avarice. I think avarice is just as prevalent in the Soviet Union as it is in Japan or in the United States. I think makes the system work is this altruistic creativity. It's its moral foundation, and combined with faith in the future, which ordinarily expresses itself in faith in God. And I think this is what makes capitalism work. And it's interesting to me that the leading socialist, or at least one of the leading socialists in America today, is John Kenneth Galbraith. And he recently has virtually given up on the development of the third world, because he decided that the crucial problem of third world poverty is that the poor people accommodate themselves to being poor. They essentially resign themselves to poverty. And he says, indeed, this is not an irrational response, it's a fully rational response to the predicament of the poor.
Right.
And in other words, and the only way they can escape poverty is to escape the countries in which they live and move to successful capitalist countries, and it was very interesting to me that after all these conditions of depressed demand and no growth and poverty prevailed everywhere in the world. And they certainly they prevailed in the United States at the early stages of our career as a country, and in England and all the most successful industrial states, and yet he can't explain growth unless it's already happening, And the reason is he can't understand why somebody would risk his life to create something without any assurance of return. He can't understand giving. And it's giving that it's giving.
Giving
that,
or risking?
Risking. But it's giving yourself.
What's different, isn't it?
Well, it's giving of yourself without any assured returns. It's giving. It's,
why
it's being willing to go out into the wilderness and
look,
build and,
if I
and
go to,
cut
if,
down.
If I go to a casino, and turn in a $100 bill and get a chip, and I stick it on three, I don't see that I'm exhibiting any particular altruistic spirit by doing that.
No, that's gambling, which is a zero-sum game. It's mm-hmm. That's why it's not risking. You asked whether they were risking. I said they were giving. And expectation without a predetermined return, giving of themselves, not just putting down some money and making no effort or and having no moral engagement in the activity that they're pursuing. That's the difference between gambling and capitalism, and a lot of people can't tell the difference, and those people develop theories like the zero-sum society and other such, because they can't understand the sources of human creativity. And because they can't understand those sources, they can't believe that they could persist. They tend to be very pessimistic about the future of the race.
Or want to give them rain.
Or want to give them rain,
yeah.
Right.
Oh, how would you comment on this assertion of Professor Galbraith, the general despondency over the lack of economic progress in the Third World?
Well, I think Ken, though usually mute, will be able to defend himself on this particular
charge. He doesn't seek to defend himself.
His
point is too fatalistic.
Yeah, I've read that. I've read the book, and I can understand his gloom, because in fact, in the Third World, what's happened has been a set of not quite invariably, because there have been some successful cases of development, but a set of generally unsuccessful episodes, some of them capitalistic, some of them socialistic, some of them miscellaneous. The Third World, with some exceptions, has behaved less progressively, both politically and economically, than the innocent members of rich societies have hoped. I don't want to get engaged, after all, in a discussion of what Ken has said, because there is an earlier point in the discussion between you, Bill, and George that I think requires comment. The difference, it seems to me, between the gambler who goes and buys himself a chip at Las Vegas and the investor who buys a machine
or a stock
is a question of probabilities, isn't it? There are people who go to Las Vegas and play blackjack, and if they're not caught by the dealers, do card counting, and thus shift the odds somewhat in their favor. I read, with admiration. I wouldn't know how to proceed, or for that matter, how to get to Las Vegas. And then there are people. There are people who buy stocks, or if they're corporate officials, commit their corporations to investments of various kinds, and they're gambling too, with calculations of odds. Keynes, when he described this, talked about the animal spirits of businessmen, the tides of optimism and pessimism which sweep over
and
them.
The inexactitude of prospectuses.
That's right, the effort to pierce the dark veil of the future, the poetic language rare among economists. I find this difficult really to distinguish.
Between high flying, high rolling,
in psychological mechanism, really.
I don't. One is. I'm not. declaring that the stock market alone would make capitalism go. I mean, I'm trying to explain the essence of capitalism, what differentiates it from other systems and systems that don't work and don't create wealth. Now, a stock market alone, without people who are willing to give their lives to these particular enterprises that rise up and down on the market as people appraise their prospects, would not engender wealth. The crucial activity of capitalism, I think, is entrepreneurship. And entrepreneurship must be based on faith in the future and an imaginative understanding of the needs of others. And that and those are the essential prerequisites of capitalist growth. This is what makes capitalism work.
And the others are mere camp followers, right?
The others are camp followers, or they're various institutions that are useful to capitalism. But I'm not, there's more to capitalism than a large society, which operates in all sorts of ways, than the precise activities on which I'm focusing in my book. I am merely saying that it is these activities that explain explain wealth, and the absence of such activities explains the deterioration of economies, and that's my essential proposition.
Okay, let's turn to a very concrete chapter in your book, in which you say that the last 10 years have devastated the whole dream of attempting by government activity to help people who live in the ghetto. What data do you adduce to make that point?
Well, I was first interested in this entire subject by Daniel Patrick Moynihan, who wrote a book on the black family. And as you recall, when that book was published in 1965, there was wild howls of alarm. This was a caricature of black society. These statistics were shockingly exaggerated. And in any case, they just by divulging such statistics of crime and illegitimacy and family breakdown, you were invidious and you were discrediting blacks. You were somehow defaming them. Well, in the 15 years since that report was released, there have been a whole mass of poverty programs enacted, which have vastly expanded the amount of income transmitted to these poor families. And there have been a war on poverty, indeed, which was accompanied by welfare rights organizations that went out into the ghetto and solicited people for the welfare benefits. They told them that they have a right to benefits, and so it was almost a matter of entrapment. People were induced to receive this kind of these kind of benefits. As a result, the amount of money and in-kind benefits which the poor receive in American society greatly increased. But all those indices of family breakdown and crime and youth unemployment, demoralization, and all those statistics which Daniel Patrick Moynihan adduced as reasons for such a war on poverty and new welfare efforts have doubled, and sometimes more than doubled. And it's my thesis that
damage has been done to the people whom we set out to help.
That's right. But not just slight damage. This is the crucial thing to understand. You break a man's family and you pretty much destroy him as an economic being. A poor man he's struggling. And if you do something to him that breaks his family, you destroy the very sources of possible upward mobility, not only for him, but also for his family. And the chief effect of the vast expansion of the welfare system was a vast expansion of family breakdowns. And that is a dreadful tragedy. It's the worst thing that's happened in America in the last 15 years. It's just an appalling, dreadful thing. And it's been done by government policy.
What makes you assume a causal relation between the program and the results? Might there have been a breakdown of the ethos as a result of other factors? The Vietnam War, the general permissiveness, the deterioration of standards, the fracturing of the ethos? Or are you saying that because you gave food stamps, free medicine, and rental subsidies, a family that would otherwise have stayed together has now separated?
Yep.
Why?
Because the foundation of families is the male role of provider. And if you destroy the man's role of provider, you destroy his major link to his children. And a man without, and it's the links of men to children that give them a sense of the future, that give them goals that induce them to submit to the very arduous disciplines of work and achievement in any society. And what these programs did was create a combination of benefits plus leisure time that was far more valuable than any earnings that the man could provide. So therefore, it destroyed his role as provider. Now, there have been, the U.S. government decided to make some studies because they were quite sure that they could show that welfare had no role in the breakdown of families. They really were very confident on this point because they'd made a number of rather foolishly designed efforts to determine this effect, and they all had indicated that welfare would strengthen families. As a matter of fact, Moynihan, who's very intelligent about many matters, actually believed that expanding welfare would reinforce families.
His FAP period.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. And, which he has renounced.
Yeah, he's now said I was wrong. Mm-hmm. And what happened was they did studies, they did an income maintenance experiment in Denver and Seattle. And they gave money to large numbers of families that had not previously been receiving it, and discovered that the effect was a 60% increase in family breakdown.
And that's a social observation more than it is an economic observation, but you probably want to comment on that, do you, Mr. Cashman?
Well, two things I'd like to say. One is that if, in fact, welfare, as George alleges, had this effect on family breakdown, we should observe something which, as far as I know, has not happened, which is this: very, very much higher indices of family stability in Texas, Louisiana, Alabama, Arkansas, and other southern states with very, very low benefits, of a sort which should not depress male earners and should in fact allow them to perform what you're describing as the traditional male role.
Do we have that control situation, George?
Yes. Yes, we've one of my findings on this came not only from the statistics, which I spent months poring over, but also from 2 years of interviews in the ghetto as part of preparation for a book called Visible Man, which compared welfare families in Greenville, South Carolina, and in the North. And the indices of family breakdown in those southern states is much lower for people, for young families. Now, it's not much lower for all families put together, because lots of people, there are a lot of older women whose husbands have gone to the North, and there are lots of people, families impacted by the earlier systems of discrimination and savagery that obtained in many of those southern states, and which also had the effect of causing the kind of turmoil that destroys families. But you can very clearly identify the difference between, and I examined it closely, the difference between the statistics of, first of all, of families in central cities in the South, after 1965, when the war on poverty began and was extended more intensively in the North than in the South. And the effect was that these families tended to break down in direct proportion to their closeness to these central cities where the poverty programs were launched and the welfare rights efforts were
several things about that. Of course, the divorce laws changed during this period. And of course, that relates to a second observation that I wanted to make on the Seattle-Denver experiments. We obviously can't conduct a statistical argument about the significance of those experiments, but my reading of them is different from yours. There was some increase in family breakup. But I could readily interpret this, and I do interpret this, as simply giving low-income families whose economic condition had been somewhat improved, according to the variant of the experiment which the family participated in, it simply gave them some leeway for the dissolution of unhappy marriages, which middle-class families have been enjoying for some time. In other words, all that the additional income gave them was an ability to act as freely as middle-class
Americans. No, but why the statistics aren't comparable, the statistics aren't comparable.
And the end result is that in black families in America, including stable middle-class families, which are not different from white families, is that 6 out of 10 black children in America are brought up without fathers in the home, while only less than 2 out of 10 white families are brought up without fathers in the home. And that is a catastrophic tragedy.
Would you regard the situation as superior if a larger percentage of black families were brought up by viciously quarreling parents, both of them in the home, actively assaulting each other, occasionally physically, frequently verbally?
I mean, I think that what we have here is a general plague of family breakdowns, and I think to characterize these families in this way just isn't valid or very significant. I mean, it's we have when you have just in the ghetto themselves virtually no families with fathers in the home, you have a really catastrophic situation, and I think that's and the result is that the boys find their masculine validation on the street and gangs.
By
and
your own description, if I remember correctly, you identify a situation 2 generations ago in which this was fairly typical of Irish families, who presumably were not afflicted by the welfare system, which was non-existent as a public phenomenon, or practically non-existent at that time, so that the phenomena were otherwise created. The ethnic group rose. And wait, what evidence is there that blacks, who in many respects are a first generation group of ethnic migrants, internal migrants rather than migrants from abroad, what evidence is there that the family condition will not improve despite welfare, or because of welfare, or regardless of welfare, in the next generation?
I devoutly pray that that will happen. I just observe that the situation is getting worse as a result of the sort of government programs that are adduced to help blacks today.
Coincidentally,
and
with government
programs.
And
the Irish situation moved in the other direction. I mean, that Irish situation got better and better after the initial stage when
and you say
of
it, immigration. You say it got better and better probably because the male in the Irish family, as the male in the Italian family or in the Jewish family, was acting out his role as the provider.
That's right.
That's your point.
That's right.
And your point is that there is no reason to suppose that that role will be available to this generation of blacks because the government is there to prevent him from acting out that role.
That's right.
Let's listen to Mrs. Harriet Pilpel, a distinguished attorney interested in families and women's rights and in literary law, an associate of Greenbaum, Wolf, and Ernst, Mrs. Pilpel.
Apparently, Professor Gilder thinks that one of the things that makes capitalism work is the subordination of women. Apparently, as he said a few moments ago, the male must be the provider. In his book that we're discussing today, he said most men make the sacrifices necessary to reach the higher reaches of the American economy to support their wives and families. When the wives earn more, the men feel a decline of urgency in their work and a loss of male nerve and drive. When the wives earn less, the men tend to work more and are far more likely to reach the pinnacles of achievement. This was such a startling paragraph that I started to read some other things that Professor Gilder had written.
I'm not a professor, by the way.
Well, I like to think
that's
of you as a professor.
Yourself.
And I found that in an article in Harper's Magazine some years ago called The Suicide of the Sexes, Professor, please indulge me, Professor Gilder said that a complete break between procreative and erotic instincts will ultimately undermine all forms of sexual pleasure. And he can say, and he also says that the conscious or unconscious desire to have children with a specific partner is a workable definition of sexual love. And finally, he says that woman loves man for his ability to control her in sexual intercourse and for his submission to the extended demands of her sexuality. At that point, I felt that either I'd been under a misapprehension about my sex all my life, or that Professor Gilder should study the female sex to a greater extent than he has successfully studied capitalism. I would like to ask him what he would do with those women who feel that their greatest happiness is not necessarily being subordinate to a male in terms of being provided for. What was that sex thing? That maybe she doesn't like being, quote, controlled in her sexual relations. She has this idea that maybe sex is a partnership between a male and a female. Maybe she feels that she has some obligation to express herself. What would you do with these women who feel this way, who must number now in the millions and millions?
What should I do with them?
Well, I mean, are you saying they're missing? You would let them, and that would mean definitely a worse effect on capitalism. Is that right?
Not necessarily. I predict that they will not, in fact, go out in the world and devote themselves so exclusively and obsessively to careers as men do.
Nobody has said that it's exclusive and obsessive except you. Women like men like to have careers and families and children and sex. And I don't know where you got this idea that somehow with them the things are exclusive, whereas a male can very well take them all in his gambit without any trouble.
Well, a man can't have children unless his paternity is acknowledged by the woman. In other words, the woman has...
Oh, my, you don't really believe that. I know you must say
that. Of course I believe that. That's a biological fact. It's not a debatable
matter. Unless his paternity is acknowledged by the woman. You don't mean his specific paternity. Unless his ability to
have a child. She does mean that.
Yes.
Well, what about the wife who says, this is not your child, this is somebody else's child? That would not be acknowledged, but it would do wonders for the guy whose child it was supposed to be, right? I mean, it really would, because that would assert his masculinity. I cannot believe that you don't think that all
I can't believe you're asking him serious questions because you don't let him answer.
He hasn't answered at all.
I've wrote two books on that subject, beyond the Harper's article.
Did you see the light? I've got
two daughters now and a wife.
How old are your daughters?
One is 2.5 and one is 6 weeks now.
Oh, I think they're going to need counseling. I would like also to address myself to your black example. I agree with everything that's been said in opposition to what you say, but I studied this whole question of the black family years and years ago, and I found that the statistics were substantially the same, if not worse, than they are now, before the government programs. In other words, I had been taught way back in the primeval days, that the reason black families had disintegrated was because during slavery they were deliberately broken up by the slave owners, and therefore they never had a chance really to coalesce again. I have also been told that there was one major mistake. I will keep still in one minute. There was one major mistake in our government policy, and that was the aid to dependent, to families with dependent children, where the man had to be out of the home to qualify for that aid, but I think that's being corrected.
It makes no difference. Absolutely no difference whether there's a legal requirement or not. If the woman can get a package of benefits that's much more valuable than anything he can earn, he will be kicked out or he will leave in most circumstances. So that, you know, the states that remove, there are 26 states that retained that requirement, and their experience was no different with regard to broken families than those states that that had the requirement that the man leave in order that the woman receive the benefits. Your statistical studies, I'm delighted to go through them with you if you want. I don't know what they are, but there's no evidence that the situation was equally bad 20 years ago or 15 years ago. Well, there isn't. And moreover, the conventional wisdom today, as a result of a lot of historical studies by Gutman, among others, is that slavery had much less impact on the black family than wasn't anticipated. And that, as a matter of fact, it certainly didn't have as destructive an effect as the welfare system has had.
Has the welfare system had an equally bad effect on the white families that are subject to welfare?
Yes, they do. But the difference is that twice as many, that a black who is poor is twice as below the age of 65 with a lot of controls to eliminate wealth distortions and other such considerations. A black is twice as likely to be on welfare as a similarly poor white.
Why do you think that is?
Because all the poverty programs focused on the ghetto. They could identify the black poor, their outreach effort concentrated on the black poor, and they succeeded in inducing the black poor to sign up for welfare. So most of the blacks who are eligible for welfare, in fact, receive it, while only less than half of the whites who are eligible for welfare receive it. So you have this big disproportion. However, this only applies in central cities, in ghetto families. Out in rural areas where the welfare bureaucracy did not concentrate, you find black and whites are equally likely to be on welfare if they're poor. So this shows that it was in the central cities where the war on poverty focused, where the Great Society programs all concentrated, that the black family was most damaged and that welfare spread.
You think the black family started at the same point as the white family in the ghettos? I mean, you think it might have something to do with discrimination against blacks in our society?
Well, I've mentioned that before. Sure, it did.
What would you do then with people who are living below the poverty level in part or in whole, not through any fault of theirs? You wouldn't have any welfare programs?
No, I'd obviously have welfare programs. I just wouldn't have welfare programs that are worth twice as much as a year's income at the minimum wage.
Well, that's
and that doesn't even include the value of leisure and all the myriad unreported sources of income which people in the ghetto receive. That, you know, the welfare system doesn't have a clue about what's actually going on. I mean, that was one benefit of my 2 years of interviews on this point. I lived on the edge of what might be called the ghetto in Albany, although it's not much of a ghetto. And they just, none of these numbers are particularly valid. And it's...
I agree with that.
And they're... But it really is clear to me that these families break down because of the attractions of the welfare system, and that these men refuse to work because they lack this kind of durable link to children, which ordinarily motivates career commitment. And it's, I think, this sort of work, which is the foundation of upward mobility in any system,
well, how can they
begins
find work
in love for women and children.
How can they find work if there's unemployment?
Well, they can, because unemployment rises and falls, but
Well, what do you do with them while they're unemployed?
What?
I mean, while they're unemployed and can't get a job, what do you do?
I'm for various systems of welfare and insurance, but I'm not for systems that are so generous that they effectively destroy families.
I dare say not.
That's
a
real difference.
Not a single person with whom you are acquainted on a social level could even live on what welfare gives.
That's false. That's one of the great myths of all time. My wife and I were living in Albany. We just decided as an experiment to live on this sort of, to see whether we could live on a welfare budget.
Did you have any children?
We didn't at that point. We therefore
and
chose
therefore
a welfare.
Therefore got less welfare.
Yeah, therefore had less welfare to count. And we had, this was in 1977, I guess, and we were allowed to spend $45 a week on food. We ate meat, we ate very well, we had, you know, we didn't have to change our eating habits or anything at all. When the Mondales tried to live on welfare for a week, and described their terrible privations. They almost couldn't survive, according to the news stories that they offered. It's just such nonsense, you can't believe it. The reason welfare families all seem totally in trouble and are in trouble is because their families are broken down. There's no nuclear family.
They don't have families to fall back on, such as
problem.
You and your wife. But I have very little time. I would like to ask you about the third world. I have heard people say that one of the reasons why the situation is so bad in the third world might be because of the capitalist system in the rest of the world and the multinational corporations, that it might have something to do with the fact that the United States, with less than 6% of the world's population, is consuming almost 50% of the world's resources, and that the profits of the resources of the third world countries are being siphoned out to the capitalist countries, leaving them with almost nothing to live on. That, at least, is what they think.
You have 20 seconds.
To laugh at the observation? I mean, you look at the third world countries that are succeeding splendidly, chiefly the Asian third world countries that have embraced capitalism and who have to pay for all their oil and all their energy from outside extorters in other third world countries. And the whole myth of exploitation as the source of wealth collapses. It's this belief, however, which is the main source of poverty in the world.
Thank you.
The belief that wealth creates poverty.
Thank you very much, George Gilder, author of Wealth and Poverty. Thank you, Professor Lekachman. Thank you, Mrs. Pilpel. And thank you, ladies of Spence, here in New York City. Thank you.
Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and by other public television stations, and by the following. For a printed-bound transcript of this program, send $2 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. Indicate the subject of the program, and please allow 3 weeks for delivery. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content.